Okay, I think we'll go ahead and get started. Thank you everyone for coming. I'd like to welcome you to this third in our seminar series on breakthroughs in water security. My name is Jeff McDonald, and before I introduce today's speaker, I also wanted to welcome our simulcast university participants, University of Manitoba, University of Calgary, University of Alberta, and the two UBC schools. We're going to try something a little different today, and that is I'll be taking questions from our outside simulcast viewers via email immediately prior to the completion of Peter's talk. So again, if you're at the other schools, you can email me your short questions and we'll repeat them and maybe lead off with those questions if there are any before we open it up. I'd also like to thank Howard Weider and the Global Institute for Water Security for a sponsorship of this seminar series. And it's a real pleasure to introduce Peter Troch. Peter's a professor at the University of Arizona in the Department of Hydrology and Water Resources, really the only department of hydrology in North America, aside from a small program at Utah State University. There's really not a competitor in this field. They offer an undergrad degree currently with about 60 undergrads who are enrolled, and this goes back, I guess, to the 1960s. Peter comes from the University of Ghent in Belgium, where he did his degrees, mostly in agricultural engineering. And he is now science director at Biosphere 2, something you'll hear about today. And he's just coming off of a stint as the principal investigator of the Critical Zone Observatory. This is a large NSF effort in the States where Peter had one of the six or so of the original Critical Zone observatories. Peter also taught at Wageningen for some years, where he interacted with one or two people in the audience who are also here from the Netherlands, up until 2005 when he made the move to University of Arizona. Peter's been very active in terms of publishing on various topics from remote sensing to soil physics, and has been highly recognized in this area. He's an editor of the journal Hydrological Processes, and he's the 2011 Dalton Medalist from the European Geophysical Union. Really the top honor from EGU for recognition in hydrology. So today the focus is on breakthroughs in laboratory experiments and water security, and we're going to hear about the Biosphere 2 experiment, and it's a pleasure to welcome Peter to Saskatoon.
Thank you, Jeff, for this generous introduction, and thank you for inviting me and have me as one of your keynote speakers in this really exciting series on water security. So being asked to talk about breakthroughs in laboratory experiments, I want to focus mainly my talk on current research activities taking place at the Biosphere 2 near Tucson, Arizona, which is currently under management of the University of Arizona. So not everybody in the audience will know what Biosphere 2 is, so I want to give a brief description of the facility. It's located north of Tucson. It's about an hour drive from main campus. And it's actually not that far from Phoenix International Airport neither. It's about an hour and a half, I would guess, to get to that place. It's in Oracle. It's basically a large greenhouse where we have several model ecosystems under the glass, from a rainforest to a savanna area, even an ocean. And within that large-scale facility, we can do controlled experiments with these model ecosystems. So we focus on exploring our capabilities of large-scale experimental research within those model ecosystems, and if you count them all up, we've got seven. And we do that with a team of interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary scientists. And because of having that put together that team, we also have a golden education and outreach opportunities. And we combine that with an on-site modern conference center so that people can organize workshops and conferences and brainstorm about the next big experiment. One of the model ecosystems I'm going to talk about today is referred to as the Landscape Evolution Observatory, or LEO. And it's the most recent addition to our measurement capabilities at Biosphere 2. You can see a picture here of the surface of the Landscape Evolution Observatory. We are looking from the downslope end of this hill slope built under the glass uphill, and we're looking at the distance of about 30 meters long and about 12 meters across. And it's built within these three bays, and each hill slope is identical in shape and instrumentation, and we'll come back to that in a minute. So this greenhouse provides us with a controlled environment where we can control temperature, humidity, CO2 concentration, any climate variable you can imagine. But because of the scale of this Landscape Evolution Observatory, we can observe Earth system processes at almost realistic or near realistic scales. So here's an artist impression of LEO. It's very hard to take pictures that shows the full span of the instruments. So this is it gives you a better impression of the three bays, the three landscapes. We have a human transporter over each of those hill slopes so that once the experiment starts, we don't have to tread on the surface, and we can leave the surface as is and evolve under natural forces of gravity and biology. And yet we have full access capabilities because of these transporters. And we can close the bays so that each can operate with its own control volume. Knowing what comes in and what goes out, we can fully mass control the experiment. The Biosphere 2 was built to isolate whatever was inside from the outside world, and it's almost perfect. The leakage rate of Biosphere 2 is less than a space shuttle, so it's pretty tight. So why did we build this instrument? What's the purpose? What's the background of LEO? And so basically the central question that we try to address is, what's the role of life in changing water, carbon, and energy budget in the landscape? So if we were able to go back in time and observe a specific part of the landscape, say this hill slope, way when it was starting to develop from whatever geological forces created its shape and its location to where it is now, then we would probably better understand the present by understanding or knowing the past. When we visit the landscape, we basically enter a scene that is very complex. It has undergone all kinds of changes because of interactions with the climate that may or may not have changed, as well as the ecosystems that developed over that landscape. So being able to reconstruct the history of the landscape as part of the puzzle of trying to understand potential future changes when land use changes occur due to anthropogenic forces or climate changes, etc. So any real system will have a history that controls the way water is moving and cycling through these hill slopes. It's controlled by bedrock slopes, soil depth, topographic convergence, the conductivity field of the soil, etc. But this partitioning of water in the landscape will further enhance or change any of the other processes that occur within the hill slope soils and ecosystems, and that have an important effect on the way it functions. For instance, microbial and plant colonization will follow the water. And if this was a very simple initial system, then these microbial processes is probably going to be the main driver initially that kind of puts the hill slope development onto a trajectory from which it is may or may not never recover. But because colonization of microbes and plants follow water, it also will have effect on the spatial and temporal dynamics of carbon sequestration, nitrogen fixation, biomass decay, hot spots and hot moments. These processes will have a major effect on subsurface structural development in terms of where carbon is stored and where fluxes occur, net ecosystem exchange further enhancing mass exchange with the atmosphere, and we will see through water biota and rock interactions, we will see soil profile development, catena formation along the hill slope, etc. Now, these subsurface structural changes will cause all kinds of changes in water flow paths and connectivities through pore formation, clogging, macro pore development, preferential flow development. Subsurface networks may or may not develop, which ultimately changes the way water is partitioned at the hill slope scale. Now, entering this scene when everything is already going on for many, many years makes it very difficult to separate cause and effect. But being able to enter the scene when this is still under development, so basically going back to time zero, is what motivates the construction of this landscape evolution observatory. And so sample research questions that we can address with this instrument are, can we close water, carbon, and energy budgets? Has anybody ever been able to close the energy, the water budget? And my answer to that question is no. Why? Because we have limited observational skills, we have limited modeling skills, etc. Same is true for carbon and energy. What's the role of plants and microbes in hill slope scale weathering pathways and fluxes? Very important question if you want to understand subsurface structural changes that affect the way water moves through the system. Can we predict that evolution? And how is that prediction going to be different in a changing climate? What's the role of establishment versus competition? A very important eco-hydrological question. And it all plays in this never-ending cycle of how water, nutrients, and carbon is cycled through the hill slope system, how it affects plant and microbial distribution, how that affects biogeo-weathering and ecosystems dynamics, and how that changes surface-subsurface flow path connectivity, et cetera, et cetera. So the instrument, as I said, is 30 meters long and 11 meters wide. It has this convergent shape, so basically three side slopes that drain into a central trough, and then there is a seepage face at the end of this slope. Going to quickly step you through the below ground instrumentation that we have in the hill slope. So each of these green dots represent transects, vertical transects, where we measure soil moisture, soil temperature, soil water potential, and we have the opportunity to sample the water as well from the soil. And we do that at 5, 20, and 50 centimeters depth. At each of these orange dots, we measure the same variables and have samplers, but we do that at 5, 20, and 35 centimeters depth. At each of these yellow dots, we again measure these same parameters, but now at four depths, 5, 20, 50, and 85. These black dots are electrodes that allow us to do electrical resistivity tomography. It's basically a geophysical method that allows us to measure and scan the subsurface structure through sending electric currents through the soil and measuring the resistivity between those different probes. And we do that at five different depths, 10, 20, 30, 50, and 75 centimeters. This, we hope, will give us a way to observe the below-ground structural changes that are caused by chemical weathering and ecosystems dynamics. At each of these blue dots, we have vibrating wire piezometers that basically allow us to measure a dynamic water table that develops during rain events. Each of these locations, we measure soil heat flux at the surface. It's part of the energy budget that we need to know in order to drive hydrological models. And then at each of these locations, we can sample the soil gas, analyze it for CO2 or any other trace gas. And we do that at 3 or 4 depths, matching the water samples that I showed before. And then at these locations, we have carbon dioxide concentration sensors measuring the CO2 concentration in the soil gas phase. These are Visala probes. So putting that all together, we basically have a measuring capability that represents more than 1,800 sensors and samplers in a soil that is 1 meter deep. And the way we designed the initial soil is that it's a ground basalt tephra, which only contains primary minerals. It has no carbon or nitrogen content at all. And so it's the basic volcanic material that that's available for life developing. It's like a lava flow, but the only difference is that we crunched it, we ground it, so that it has the water holding capacity of a soil. But other than that, it just have nutrients have to come from chemical weathering, or nitrogen has to be assimilated through fixation. The above ground instrumentation quickly are vertical profiles of temperature, humidity, and air intake points for water vapor and CO2 analysis. We've got 5 positions along each vertical. As you can see, we've got 5 of these verticals, 3 along X and then 2 off axis, and those 2 are west facing and east facing, so that we can also look at differences in aspects. The off-axis vertical profiles also have a 4-way radiometer, so we know the energy budget over those different facing side slopes. We've got a central 3D anemometer measuring turbulence. And then we've got hyperspectral and thermal imaging systems mounted on a track system that allows us to move this to any position above the hill slope with an accuracy of about 1 millimeter, so we can do repeat measurements as the system evolves and plants grow on it and soil surfaces change because of physical or chemical weathering. So to conclude the overview of the instrumentation capabilities or measurement capabilities of the LEO instrument, we've got a fixed sprinkler system that delivers rain rates at a rate between 4 and 48 millimeters per hour. And we've got a set of sprinkler heads here that produce a spatial pattern of rain distribution that is typical distribution is seen over here. It's not perfect, it's not a homogeneous field, but it's close to being near homogeneous. We measure seepage phase flow at the downstream end of the hill slope by dividing the seepage phase into 6 sections, and each section drains into a tipping bucket gauge that you can see here. And before it tips into this tipping bucket, we've got, and it's probably hard to see from where you sit, we've got these electromagnetic flow meters that measure the flow rate through the pipes. And so this combination of gauges will give us better measurement capabilities because the tipping bucket rain gauges, they are more sensitive in the low flow rates, whereas the flow meters are more sensitive in the high flow rates. And so combining them gives us a better measurement capability of seepage phase flow. Each hill slope sits on what we call load cells or scales, basically. And so these scales, these load cells, allow us to observe mass changes due to rainfall, evaporation, or seepage outflow. When we combine all 10 load cells for 1 hill slope, we can basically observe when we add water to the hill slope how the mass is increasing. And if this instrument is doing its job correctly, and during a constant rain event, we would expect this to be a linear increase in mass, and the slope of which would be the rain rate. So this is an example of a measurement that we made in February of this year, where we tested the load cell capability, and it's better than a centimeter of water accuracy. We can compare that with a integration of all the soil moisture probes that we have inside the soils. We've got about 500 of these soil sensors that measure moisture content. So we can convert that to a mass across the hill slope. Then we can compare this trace with the previous trace. And because of spatial heterogeneity and the subsurface wetting, we see some deviations from the ideal trace of a linear increase during a rain event. But overall, the maximum accumulation estimated by the soil moisture probes is quite representative of what we measure directly by our scales, which is quite encouraging. So there is built-in redundancy in the instrument so that we can double-check certain measurements, make sure that we can make the right interpretation. We can collect water samples from our soil lysimeters. And this is the syringes that are connected to these soil lysimeters. And if you have an army of grad students, then you can scan or you can sample during rain events, because sampling 500 lysimeters takes a lot of time. So we are currently developing an automatic system that would pull a vacuum in accordance to the tensiometer readings for that particular location. That's something that is still under development. So that kind of gives you an overview of the measurement capabilities of LEO. We talked about the background, the motivation behind it. We call it the Landscape Evolution Observatory because we want to observe how landscapes evolve. And we are interested in interactions between the biotic and the abiotic processes that take place at the Earth's surface. Now, the reason why we do that is to enhance our understanding of Earth system processes. And the way we want to extrapolate that knowledge or transfer that knowledge is by improving our modeling capabilities. Each of the disciplines that are represented in this project, from hydrology to geomorphology to geochemistry, they all have their knowledge assembled through models. That's basically the translation of what we know about the dynamics of the processes. And so now we are in a position that we can look at those models, see if they can make the right predictions under certain boundary conditions and hypotheses, and then test those predictions, see whether they are capable of providing us with the right information about what is expected to happen. So one of those models that we are currently working on is a 3D hydrological model based on Richard's equation, and coupled that with a land surface water, carbon, and energy budget model that is typically used in global circulation models or weather prediction models. And in this particular case, we're using NOAA MP. And so these two separate models that are kind of doing similar things but in different ways are now fully coupled so that the carbon cycle informs the water cycle and is driven by the energy cycle. And so we have further extending our modeling capabilities by adding transport to our hydrological model. Eventually, that will be including also reactive transport, and chemical weathering leads to solutions that transport through the system. And eventually, there will be maybe an ecosystems dynamics model added to this land surface model. So once these models are in place, we can actually use them to make predictions. And that's exactly how we operate the instrument. So we formulate hypotheses or interesting research questions. We call our modelers and ask, can you model this for us? Can you predict what we might expect? And when the expectation is manageable in the sense that it's not causing major disruption of the system, then we can go ahead and plan the experiment, run the experiment, and then collect the data. Once the data is collected, we can go back to the model prediction and say, where did it deviate? or were we spot on? And if we were wrong, why were we wrong? Is it because of we missed the process or we missed parameter sets or whatnot? So here's an example of a model prediction that informed an experiment. So the idea was to start a rainfall event at constant rate for a very long time. And the reason why we chose this step function was that once we start adding rain at a constant rate, at some point, the hill slope will come into a steady state. The water that comes into the hill slope will move out of the hill slope, and we would reach this steady state. With one set of parameters for the soil in LEO, the model predicted exactly that. This is the change in storage, subsurface storage, expressed in cubic meters here. So initially you expect a linear increase in accumulated storage, and when it reaches a steady state, the storage will become constant, right? Because we are still raining on it, but now we've got seepage flow moving that water out of the hill slope. So after about 12 hours, we predicted that the hill slope would reach a steady state. That, of course, depends on the parameter values that we use for that run. If we change the parameter values, I'm not going into the details here, but those are parameters that just inform the hydrologic model. If we change those, then the model reached steady state at much later times. So that was basically what we expected to happen. We would reach a steady state within reasonable time, so we wouldn't have to rain on it for days and days. And then once the system was brought into a steady state, we could see how it would relax from that steady state. Now, from a hydrological perspective, that's an important experiment because it informs you about the total dynamics involved. And it has never been done, or hardly ever been done. It's very hard to do that in the real world. Rain on a hill slope until it reaches a steady state is very difficult. There are a couple of attempts out there, but not that many successful. Okay, so here is this lower panel shows the overland flow, and the red line is observed overland flow. So you see there is no blue prediction of overland flow. The model basically predicted that all the water would move from rainfall into runoff through subsurface seepage flow. And then when we turned off the rain, it would relax back into a drier state. But what was observed, though, was a significant amount of surface runoff that was produced because of saturation of the hill slope. Because of that saturation, we saw significant erosion and gully formation in the central trough of the landscape. So we are looking again, here's the seepage phase, so it's the downhill, this is uphill. You can see the convergence shape of the terrain model, and then the formation of this meandering channel bed embedded in an abundant terrace shape that was caused by outcropping of groundwater and the formation of saturation excess overland flow. This was not expected, was not anticipated, was not wanted even, because we were still in commissioning phase. It was bad news that we kind of lost 0.7 cubic meters of soil. But when you serve lemons, you make lemonade. And the data set that we collected during this this experiment can now be mined for better understanding what went on during that experiment. So when we looked at the observations, including the surface runoff, we could now optimize the model parameters, because once you have dynamic observations, you know, you have more information than what you a priori had to estimate or assume the soil parameters to be. And so now these are new parameter values that we can apply to predict the next experiment. And so when we compare the model predictions with the observations, we do see a very close match between storage dynamics, so almost a perfect match during the rising limb and a very good match during the recession part of the event. And also the amount of seepage predicted by the model is much closer to the observed seepage flow than what we previously had. There is some discrepancy here, but that's not entirely the problem of the model. There is also some underestimation of the seepage flow due to instrumental failure. So we know that this is definitely a lower limit to the flow that took place that period. So we kind of closed the loop. We made a prediction. We ran an experiment, collected data, went back to the predictions, saw what was wrong, tried to fix at least in terms of optimized parameter values. But of course, there can also be something more fundamentally wrong with the model. There may be one or two processes that we have not anticipated. And so that's where the opportunities for breakthroughs come. But when you have all these observations at these high spatial and temporal resolutions, is there something that we've been missing all along because we just didn't have the observational capabilities? So now I want to talk a few minutes about some recent results from a data analysis based on the data set that I just described. So what I'm going to show you is some data from a transect, a cross-section. We will refer to that as cross-section B. So we will see how the soil moisture evolved during the experiment in this cross-section. And we will also look at a cross-section A, which is a longitudinal cross-section, just to look at the subsurface saturated conditions. The dots are the locations where we have soil moisture measurements. Remember, at different depths along the vertical. And then the triangles are locations where we have our piezometer, so where we would observe the water table dynamics. And that's just for one hill slope. So we just run that experiment on one hill slope. So here's what we observed. And this is just an example of one of these verticals where we measured soil moisture. But this is a pattern that kept repeating itself in each of the verticals that we looked at. So we're looking at the increase of volumetric water content as we saturate the hill slope. So zero is the time of rainfall. And remember, the rain lasted for about 22 hours. Then we switched off the rain because we saw this gully formation. We started at the shallower depths, 5, 20, and 50 centimeters at pretty dry conditions, only 10% volumetric moisture content. And only the lower sensor at 85 centimeters had an initial moisture content of about 23%. Now, the interesting thing is when we started raining at a constant rain, the 5-centimeter sensor, the soil moisture, jumped very quickly, you know, within an hour, from its initial moisture content to a new equilibrium of about 35%. And then a very slight increase, but almost not observable, and definitely within the range of the accuracy of the instrument. The same happened for the 20-centimeter probe. A very quick rise once that wetting front moves into the soil, and then it stays constant. Same for 50 centimeters, but of course, delayed in time. So the time that this sensor at 5 centimeters started to respond to the wetting front passing was earlier than the one at 20 and was earlier than the one at 50. But all three of them saw a step function response to that wetting front moving down. Now, the 85 centimeter probe is so close to the bedrock that it never saw that. It jumped right into saturation. So the 85 centimeter, once it starts rising, it kind of never stops rising until it reaches a point where it's above the porosity of the soil, which is estimated at about 39%. And when it's above, the sensor basically, its reading has to be interpreted as being just fully saturated, because above 39%, it's not a physical measurement anymore. Second thing we observe here is that after this initial first step and into this new equilibrium phase, once the water table develops from below, the moisture content jumps into a second phase. And now, of course, the sequence of events is reversed. It happens first at 50, then at 20 centimeters, and then finally at 5 centimeters. When the 5 centimeter jumps above that dotted line here, that means the water table has reached the surface. And that could be the phreatic, the capillary fringe, or it can be the actual water table. So this two-step saturation process is something that is very hard to observe in reality, because you never have conditions where the rain rate stays constant for such a long time. And that's one of the conditions that you need in order to observe this. But the careful observer in the room probably would have also already seen something else that is kind of puzzling about this figure, and I'll come back to that in a minute. So here's how this two-step saturation process propagated through the hill slope when we look at this longitudinal cross-section. I'll refer to phase one as the initial condition. And then phase two is when we jump into that first step and into a new equilibrium. And then phase three is when the sensors jump into saturation. Okay? So anything dark blue is saturated. Anything light blue is initial condition. And then the color in between is that unsaturated wetting front moving through the hill slope. So this is T0. 5 hours into the experiment, we see this wetting front has moved almost everywhere to the same depth. So we see a constant infiltration front moving vertically. Then at some point, T11, some parts of the sensors just above the bedrock start showing saturation. So we see a buildup of a water table, or at least a full capillary fringe. And then that, of course, builds up after 16 hours. We reached the surface here, although it was already saturated near the surface very early into the experiment, which may or may not be anomaly or something due to heterogeneity in the rain system. And then after 22 hours, we see full water table being developed, which causes this gully erosion, this groundwater surface water interaction. This is even more clear when we look at this cross-section B. So here, initial condition, then we see a uniform wetting front moving down into the hill slope. Then once that wetting front reaches the bottom, we see a rising water table, and we see a stronger rise in the central trough compared to the side slopes, which is sometimes referred to as a groundwater ridging. This causes a reversal of flow actually from the trough back into the side slopes. But of course, the main flow is downhill. And then once that ridge reaches the surface, we get a formation of saturation excess overland flow. This has been talked about in the literature a lot, but has never been documented in ways that I can demonstrate you here with 500 sensors in a relatively homogeneous soil. So to further illustrate this point, I just want to run this video quickly. So what we were looking at is these step changes encoded in these different color codes, same as we had in the previous graphs. So anything that turns out dark blue is a saturated layer. You can see the formation of this groundwater ridge here. And then I'll run it one more time. So you see the first step. This water is moving almost homogeneously downhill, down vertically. Then it hits the bedrock. You can see the formation of this groundwater ridge here, saturating the central trough and creating all the erosion that occurred. This is the accumulation of total mass. The black line is where we, I'm not sure if I'm still on camera, so let me back up here. So the black line on the lower right panel is the mass accumulation measured with our load cells. And as you expect, when we have hardly any seepage coming out of the hill slope, then you expect this to be almost a linear line. This dotted line is the accumulation based on the soil moisture measurements. And as you can see, we've got an overshoot, a significant overshoot, which is due to the fact that we've got many of our samples are measuring more than what is physically possible, higher than total porosity. But when we cap it to that 39% maximum capacity or porosity, then we match exactly the total mass accumulation that is measured with the load cell, which gives us a fair amount of confidence in our soil moisture measurements. It's not like we're totally off chart. I think we've got a relatively good quantitative measurement of moisture buildup as long as we make sure that we interpret the signal correctly. So what I'm looking at here now is in blue is the propagation of the wetting front as it moves vertically into the soil. So this is the time in the experiment where the 5-centimeter probe steps from phase one to phase two. So it goes into that first saturation step. This is when it happens at 20 centimeters, 35, 50, and then 85. Believe it or not, there are whiskers on here. So we have averaged all the times when this 5-centimeter probe jumps into this second phase and then looked at the standard deviation. And it's on schedule at 5, 20, 35, 50 centimeters. It happens at exactly the same time all across the hill slope. This is a linear progression of the wetting front, and we know exactly the velocity. It's 7 centimeters per hour. Rain rate, 12 millimeters per hour, 1.2 centimeters per hour. Infiltration rate, wetting front, propagation, 5 times larger. Then once it hits the bottom, we see the reverse, the increase of water table, which again propagates linearly upwards, and it happens at 50, 35, 20, and 5 centimeters. There's a little bit more variability here, but still a lot of confidence in the exact timing. And the way it propagates upwards is it happens in the convergent parts first, so that groundwater ridging, and then the side slopes or upslope area is moving later. So again, a really interesting way of visualizing what happens during this formation of saturation excess overland flow, not necessarily discovering new processes, but definitely documenting it much better than what we could do before. How much time do you have, Jeff?
Yeah, 5-7 minutes.
Okay. Okay, here's the puzzle. When we run our numerical model, vertical, just a 1D vertical column, with the soil parameters that we now have a much better parameterization of because we compare it with the observed flows. We run the model, and we try to reproduce what we've observed. These are the two steps that we see also happening in our observations. So the 5 centimeter is the red line. So as soon after the onset of rainfall, we see this 5-centimeter probe reaching an equilibrium, unsaturated. But the step is it's much slower. It reaches that new equilibrium much slower. At 20 centimeters, as expected, it turns on a little bit later. And here's the surprising thing. They all converge to the same soil moisture, which is what you would expect if the soil is homogeneous. Because once the wetting front has passed and has created a new equilibrium, the change in moisture content is zero in time, and therefore the flux has to be the same at every depth, which means we need to have the same moisture content at every depth. That's what Darcy, that's what Richards tells us. That's what the model does. We should not expect anything else than what we see here. Now, this is what we see. We don't see a convergence to a same moisture content when the wetting front appears. They are actually, this is the moisture profile that occurs when we reach that equilibrium. 5 centimeters is here, about 35%. Then the 20 centimeter probes are here, 35, the 50. What can explain this pattern? A homogeneous soil, this would be a uniform profile. That's what theory tells us. There are a couple of hypotheses that might explain this. One is differences in hydraulic conductivity with depth. But in order to recreate this pattern, actually what we need to assume is that the hydraulic conductivity increases with depth. That is, that the soil has a higher saturated hydraulic conductivity as we move into the soil profile. That's at least a controversial hypothesis. But when we run it, when we run our models, and unfortunately I couldn't add this to the presentation because I got the results in this morning. When we run the model, we can reproduce this equilibrium profile, but we have to change the saturated hydraulic conductivity by almost two orders of magnitude. Now, if that would be true, what caused that heterogeneity? Packing would give us the opposite. So there are a couple of interesting, intriguing observations that are just scratching the surface, and they're fascinating to look at. I'm not going to go there. So we do have a plan to add vegetation to this hill slope after we've been playing with the bare soil system, and we think we understand enough of it to move on. Because once we add vegetation to the hill slope, all hell breaks loose in terms of complexity. And so we are currently looking into a couple of grassland communities that are representative of the southwest of the U.S. Those would be easy to add if they are able to germinate. We are currently testing that. And then what happens if we introduce some shrubby plant or some invasive species? What happens to the ecosystem? Can we predict that response of these different plant types and functional types? Is the ecological community ready to make those predictions? And will they be right, or will they be wrong as the hydrological community was? So those are all intriguing opportunities that we can embrace. And my dream is that we will be able to create this community of earth scientists that see this as their telescope. They really want to rent some time and look at a specific problem through the eyes of this instrument. And we build it for that community, and we hope the community will come and help us run it in ways that will make all of us look good. So I just want to throw in a pitch for the conference center. We've got this beautiful village. Here's the biosphere, here's the village. So it's just, you know, 2 minutes walk. It's built in this southwestern casita style. And we've got about 120 beds. So if you ever are looking for a place to organize workshops where you know people are not going to run away because this is far from everywhere, and there are mountain lions and rattlesnakes. So people better stay close to the village. Then this is a good place to have it. And you know what? In January, that's how the weather looks like. But without the freezing cold that you have here. So with that, I just want to throw in a few conclusions. And hopefully I was able to, convince you of those, that the Landscape Evolution Observatory, and obviously more generally the biosphere too, with all the other biomes, it really offers unique collaborative research opportunities for Earth scientists. And I hope that just by giving you, by showing you some examples of data analysis, I was able to convince you of that. Basically, our philosophy is that we, through interactive cycles of large-scale experimentation and numerical modeling, we try to gain, we make rapid progress in our understanding of these coupled Earth surface processes. And it's truly a fun game to play, to challenge the numerical modeler to come up with a prediction and then prove him wrong. And of course, you want to be on the right side of the debate. But we do collect vast amounts of data that can be mined for all kinds of purposes, improving parameterizations that are critical to accurate Earth systems modeling. And really, we don't have all the hands and the brains that we need. So these data are publicly available. If you're ever interested in using some of the data, please send me an email. I'll make sure that you get access to the database. It's really user-friendly to use, and some of the data is under some level of embargo because of all the analytical time that goes into it, analyzing isotope concentration, etc. But even that data at some point will become available to the wider community. So that's it. Thank you a lot for your attention.
Well, thanks very much, Peter. This is so exciting, and we're really hoping to set up some strong collaborations between University of Saskatchewan and University of Alberta. I'll be spending the winter with Peter, which will be very nice, and Wilhelmine is coming down, I think, in October. Wilhelmine, yep. Apples from the Institute. We have Sandra Timzik from the Institute coming down in January for a short course, mm-hmm. and Chris Gabrielli we hope to get down in the winter for some collaborative work. But again, I think a key point is that this is completely open access. And that is really a game changer for how collaborations can be established. And I think when it's 40 below here, Arizona seems very attractive. When it's 40 above, yep. in Arizona, Saskatoon seems very attractive. And we'd really like to try and work this collaboration. And Andrew with your groundwater model and many, many others with different approaches, I think this is really a potential for interaction. So I'm looking at my computer, Genevieve or Masaki, if you want to email me your questions. I still have my laptop. But while we await, we might just start off with some student questions. Of course, we run a journal club associated with the speakers each week, and I promised the students I'd create uncomfortable silences until questions were asked to kick things off. So we'll go to the back and then open it up to everyone. Please. And you can use the microphone if you could, because we're... just run up there. If you could just go to the microphone in the middle.
I have the question on slide two-step saturation process. There is one graph.
This one?
Yes. There are 5 centimeters. This is the rainfall depth, right? These are 5 centimeters, 50 centimeters.
Those are the depth of the sensors. So 5 centimeters refers to a sensor that is buried 5 centimeters into the soil.
Okay.
Then the 20 centimeter is 20 centimeters, etc.
Okay. So in this figure, this 85 centimeter, it starts very high, right?
Yep.
You can go modeled one-dimensional infiltration dynamics, there is one graph.
This one?
No, then, yeah, this one.
Yeah.
There's 85 centimeter Actually, there is one pattern. My question is, there is one pattern. If we see from 5 centimeter, it starts high, then it then slower. Again, this 85 centimeter is slower.
Yeah.
But in the previous figure, 85 centimeter is quite random, right?
Yeah, that, yeah. Okay, so I think I get the question. So the 85 centimeter, remember that's 85 centimeter below the surface. And that's that sees a higher moisture content than the others, just because it stays wetter near the bedrock as the soil tries to dry out because of bare soil evaporation. So that's a typical pattern that we see, and there's a heterogeneity in the initial conditions. Now, in the modeling case that I showed you here, the modeling case, we assume the initial moisture content to be the same.
Okay.
We could have assumed it to be different at the 85 centimeter, a little bit higher, but it wouldn't have changed the results that much.
Okay.
So it's just a difference between an assumption in the model and the observation.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thanks.
Other questions? Yeah.
Hi, so my question's regarding all of the sensors that you put into the hill slope experiment. So you said over 1,800 per hill slope. I'm just wondering, in my mind, I think of that many sensors, and I think of all the space it takes up, and them acting as flow obstructions, I guess, for the water. So did you consider the density or the number of sensors when you were outfitting these hill slopes?
Mm-hmm. So if you do back of the envelope calculation really quickly. So we've got 30 by, say, 12 meters. That's 334 square meters. It's 1 meter depth. So that's 334 cubic meters. The sensors that we place are pretty small. So basically talking about something like this, a couple of inches long and maybe an inch or two wide. So if you accumulate all that volume of the sensors, 1,800, and you compare it with the total soil volume, it's still less than 1%. It's actually far less than 1%. So it sounds a lot, and it is a lot, but in terms of disturbance, it's still relatively mild.
Okay.
Now, there's wires connected to that. I worry more about the wires, actually, than the actual sensors, because the wires kind of are highways for water moving along their surface, and so we try to be smart about that. But you know, whenever you probe something, you're going to change it. It's part of the measurement paradox. But yeah, it's a good point, and it's kind of exaggerated by the dramatic pictures that I had there with all the dots, trying to impress you guys.
Hmm.
But of course, what I did was scare you. You know, that looks impressive, but
I guess another part of that question is, do you think you could be more or less accurate if you increased or decreased the number of sensors?
Has that
ever been looked at or considered?
Yeah. Yeah, we looked at it. It's a concern. You know, when do we lose observability? What happens if several years into the experiment, 30% of our soil moisture probes stop working? So we ran experiments. We call that inverse modeling or data simulation. So basically, the objective is to be able to reconstruct the conductivity field of the subsurface. You do that through inverse modeling to match your simulations of the model with observations. Mm-hmm. Now, imagine we reduce significantly the amount of observations. Are we still able to reconstruct the conductivity field? Since this is an observatory, that's a critical thing to have, right? And our initial computations indicated that we can lose 2/3 of our soil moisture probes and still reconstruct the conductivity field. But that's under synthetic ideal conditions, and so I wouldn't like to lose 2/3 of the soil moisture.
Okay, good. Thank you very
Thanks.
Much.
Yeah. Time for a couple more questions. What about the packing, just as I look for hands here? Tell me about the bulk density change with depth. What was your strategy there?
Strategy was to create a bulk density that was constant with depth. When we tested the bulk density by taking soil cores from a similarly packed soil, but not from the LEO instrument, we noticed a small increase with depth. So the deepest layer had a slightly higher bulk density. Top of my head, it went up from 1.4 grams per cubic centimeter to 1.55 or something like that. Mm-hmm. Its effect on the water retention characteristic was minor. And that increase in density with depth is counter to the apparent increase in conductivity. So there's a puzzle.
Mm-hmm. And your capillary fringe height was
30 centimeters.
30, yeah.
Yeah. And we tested that. So as soon as the sensor, soil moisture sensor, comes into that range of capillary fringe, it's saturated.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's very sensitive to full capillary conditions.
Right.
Yeah.
We're going to shift to Andrew if you can use the mic.
Yeah. So it's generally the case that we learn something when our models fail. And I think you said the hydrological model here failed, but it wasn't 100% clear to me how it failed. And sort of fundamentally, is what you're the data you're showing doesn't seem to be inconsistent with the Darcy Richards theory. Is that the case or not?
Uh-huh. So, okay, I'm sorry for not being clear on that. So when we ran the model prior to running the experiment, basically the main question I had, is there a risk that we would generate overland flow? So when we ran the model, that was the main question. That was what we were looking at. And the answer was, with those parameter values that were taken from particle size distribution functions, because remember, the only measurement we had so far was lab-tested soil. So based on those lab-derived parameter values that we applied to the entire hill slope, the answer to my question was, no, there's no risk of generating overland flow, even if you want to run it into a steady state. Mm-hmm. And the second part of the question was, how long will it take? Because we've got a limited capacity of storage to rain on it. So at some point, we will run out of water. We can't pump it quick enough, basically, and run it through the reverse osmosis system. And the answer was, it will happen within 24 hours. Which is a reasonable time of an experiment. The reason why we wanted to bring it to steady state was to create the perfect conditions to look at tracer transport. You know, as you know, most of our theory is based on steady state assumptions about groundwater flow through an aquifer, and then how transport occurs within that aquifer, what drives the diffusivity. Mm-hmm. So under those ideal conditions, but in a real scale, large scale experiment, we were aiming for those questions. The model failed in the sense that it was wrong. We did see a significant amount of overland flow. And it's because those parameter values, they don't scale to the hill slope scale. We needed a different set of parameter values in order to get the observations right. One of the hypotheses we're currently playing with is that when we run the model in a heterogeneous setting, that means we allow for some heterogeneity in the hydraulic structure from uphill to downhill, that's when we can reproduce the observations best. And so the hypothesis behind that is that because of you've got a slab of soil, it has no cohesion at all, sitting on a 10-degree slope, and you're making it soaking wet, that's going to cause some downward pressure. Is that enough of a change in the vertical, in the lateral downslope direction that causes compaction near the seepage phase that would cause the obstruction to flow that led to the saturation of the hill slope? Those are the type of things we need to look at.
Yeah, great. Okay, we're just on 6 minutes after, so I think we'll draw it to a close. Before I thank Peter, I just want to remind everyone that There will be a movement towards Alexander's after the talk, and I'd encourage you to come and join us. And that next week we have Keith Bevan with us from Lancaster University. He'll be giving a lecture on Thursday. So if you can join us next week. It won't be on Wednesday at 4, but it'll be on Thursday at 4. And Leslie will be sending out email reminders as we go into next week. Any final announcements? I think that's it. Peter, thank you very much for a very stimulating talk, and I hope everyone is just seeing enormous opportunity for collaboration with Peter, the university, and Biosphere 2 as we move forward. And again, hope to see you all later tonight at beer.
Yeah, and we run undergrad programs as well. We do have very successful REU program. Mm-hmm. So that's research experience for undergrads. I know that's probably a US limited program, but we can have parallel sessions for people that are interested in joining us for summer.
Great. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much.